for the rest of, you know, your life, then you're, you will have fewer health complications that could be brought about from alcohol. Okay? Just practicing some basic words like that. What questions might you have about this? You know, is there anything you're wondering about? Give them a chance. You always want to let people have a question, and open-ended questions are the best. Most of the time, people are going to be like, no. You might get a question like, well, what if I used to drink a lot more for 10 years? Okay. And the answer to that probably is, we don't know. But good that you stopped, or good that you reduced it. How'd you do that? Right? Reinforcing. Anytime you throw an open-ended question, that's a form of reinforcement and affirmation. How'd you do that? Good job. Is it still hard for you? Because you might want to know if it's still hard for them to, if they're still kind of having a battle. Okay? Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, next slide. All right. Now we're going to go to what we call the brief intervention. And here's the brief intervention. Looks easy. It's not quite as easy as it looks. There are some certain goals. I've alluded to them before, but what you want to do is take the presenting problem, whatever that is. So someone's in to see you for something, right? They had an accident. They broke their foot. They have high blood pressure. They have diabetes. They are anxious or having sleep problems. You know, whatever they came in for today. They might actually be there because they're in for a wellness check. They're in for a checkup. That's still their presenting concern. It's not a problem, but that's what they're there for. So you want to always tie whatever you're doing to that. That's what they came for. That's what helps reduce the stigma of this whole conversation. You're meeting their needs and giving them what they came in for that day by including this information because it's a valid part of their care. You will also take the screening results. And both of those things are going to be how you introduce the whole conversation. Those two things are going to help raise their awareness of the problem. Again, we're talking about a brief intervention, not the people that are okay. We're talking about the people who are in the risky. Get your card back out. We're talking about the people in the purple and gold area when we're talking about having this brief intervention, this particular brief intervention. If you can increase their awareness of the problem and how it plays into their health, that will help with motivation. But then you're going to use some tools that'll help further with motivation, which is the motivation interviewing skills we're going to talk about in the conversation. And hopefully that leads to behavior change as they leave. So that's what we're trying to do in 10 minutes. How many of you have seen this before, the cycle of change? Maybe a third of you. People seldom go from hearing a message on television to change. Like, as soon as the commercial's over, I've changed, I'm done. It takes going through a process. The process can take just a few minutes, or it can take years on end for people to go through. And the process, a lot of people that come in, especially those that are drinking maybe, say a female that's drinking about 10 to 14 drinks a week, you know, she's having a glass or two of wine with dinner every night. She's going to be, what? I've never heard this before. And if that's their response, where are they on the chart? Pre-contemplation, exactly. And you will have people that are definitely in pre-contemplation. You will have as many, if not more, who are more into contemplation in that they have kind of wondered if they might be drinking more than is, you know, good for them, but they're not sure and they've never known how to bring it up. There'll be people like that as well. So, you know, if someone's dependent, they are definitely already in contemplation, but they may never go to preparation. Sometimes they don't go on to preparation for change. But this is the basic change cycle, and people don't smoothly move through the whole thing and then they're done and the change is forever after. There's a whole spiral of relapse. How many of you have, you know, first time you decide to up your exercise, you stayed with it the rest of your life? Not I, for sure. You know, diet changes. We know. Look at your own behaviors. We go forward in fits and starts, and then we backtrack, and we forget all about it. And then we kind of, oh, okay, I got to get back on that, and something happens, and then they backslide again. But they say, if you can get a behavior ingrained for at least 2 weeks, where you're doing it every day consistently, then the odds are pretty high that behavior will stay and stick around. Yeah.
Just kind of a little point to make when you're with a patient. Let people know that this kind of thing does happen.
Yeah.
As they make a step into it. And when they tell you, when they've had a good visit, then they have a bad visit, don't let disappointment show on your face, because that's the judgment piece. They say, well, I've done it, and you're just kind of like, oh, and they will get your sense of disappointment that you haven't done right. So just say, you can feel bad for them that they've had this little setback, but then you can also validate, this is, you're doing fine. This is kind of a normal part of moving towards a new change you can stay with. So it's all part of the game all the time.
You can normalize it, and you can also say, you know, because you don't want to increase someone's guilt, because that doesn't get anywhere. Guilt and shame do not lead to behavior change. Mm-hmm. They just don't. They keep people from it. People fight against it, they'll get into denial, it starts off, you know. So it doesn't get you anywhere. Pragmatically, just guilt and shame, not where you want to be. Don't want your, you want to minimize that in your patients as best you can. On the other hand, in addition to saying it's okay, this is kind of normal how people go through, and what did you learn from this setback you had? Mm-hmm. What'd you learn from it? How was that for you? What might you do differently next time? Have you thought about that? So you can ask them some questions. Again, your job is not to give them the answers. I know that's totally the antithesis of much of your training, the rest of your career in this program. But when it comes to this, you don't want to give them answers. You can give them ideas. You can say, one of the things I love to say is, well, I've had some other clients, we call them clients in my profession, I've had some clients or patients who have found this way of doing things helpful. Maybe that's helpful for you. But I won't tell people this is what you should try. Yeah.
You know, something else is kind of interesting to say is, you know, I know you're disappointed today, but we also know something else. You have done extremely well in other times.
Yeah.
So what was happening when you felt like you were doing really well? So then you go right back to what they do good, and then that lets them, that they can begin to reestablish confidence that I can do this. You're still with them.
And how can I help you today get back where you were?
Exactly.
How can I help you? You know, you're going to develop what I call hip pocket questions, that if you're not sure what else to say, these questions are gonna be in your hip pocket. And you can kind of, they're almost universal. you can always kind of toss one out if you're not sure what else to do. And that's one of them. Okay, so I don't, you can actually show patients the cycle of change if you were, you know, so inclined. I mainly have this here because I want you to see it. I want you to understand the cycle of change. And that people do relapse, and helping them to know that, you know, there's learning from the relapsing and how to come back up. And usually the cycle of change is faster after a relapse. So there has been learning involved in how to do it, how to do behavior change. Okay. I can't say it's enough. You want them to find their reasons for change. Now, one of them's likely whatever it was they came in for that day, because they wouldn't have come in to see you if they didn't want some help with that. That's why we tie it to that. I know that sounds very elementary, but it's something to keep in mind. That's what they came in for, whatever the reason is they're there today. So that's how you can help find one of their personal and compelling reasons. You want to help them build readiness to change, and you would like them to make some level of commitment. By commitment, I don't mean, you know, a vow of forever after. I mean some, yeah, I think I'll try a few of these things, kind of become part of the conversation. So when we have a brief intervention, there's usually 5 steps to it, and it's really good if you try to hit these 5 steps. You can go a little bit out of order, or they can kind of slosh over into one another, but if you don't do each of these 5 areas, you probably won't be as effective, okay? That's why we're breaking this out. There are these different steps. So the first one is initiate the reflective discussion. And how you do that is usually bringing up that screening tool and saying, so you filled out a screening tool in the waiting room. Thank you very much for doing that, by the way. Appreciate your information. And would you like to know how it turned out? You know, people always want to know about themselves, right? They, you know, how many of us have filled out the questions in the, you know, different magazines about where do you rate, right? We're all attracted to that stuff. And so your clients, your patients are actually going to want to know where do they stand on this little screening tool that they did. And it's also going to be somewhat of a novelty. Although there is a chance that this gets to be so commonplace it's no longer a novelty. I'm not sure that's a bad thing at all, but I do think that right now it's still a novelty, so people are kind of curious about it. And so, you know, would it be all right if we go ahead and have a conversation about this? Even if they've indicated, I usually want to ask that question, because why would you want to ask, is it okay? So you don't offend them.
Establish rapport and trust.
Rapport and trust, because it's empowering. They get to be a little bit in the driver's seat. You're also signaling them. This is going to be interactive here. This isn't going to be you being passive while I tell you everything. So right from the beginning, I want you to be active. And I want you to say yes, because when you've said yes, you would engage in this conversation. You are going to engage in a conversation more quickly. Okay. Here's an example. Would it be all right with you? Spend a few minutes. Can we go over this? I have some information for you I'd like to share, and then I want to hear from you about it. You want to provide feedback. That's part of this step. Providing feedback. We do that by showing people where they fall out. You can do that visually with the card. So, you know, would it be all right if I show you where you fell out on this card? This card represents all of the population, okay? And about 78% of people fall into this category here, which is they have basic, you know, they drink, but it's healthy, or they don't drink at all. And about 9% fall in right here, and this is where you are right here. And it's what we call the risky area of drinking. And we'll, I can share a little bit more information about that. And then, you know, people up here are dependent on alcohol. So I want you to hear that we're not talking about you having, you know, an alcohol disorder at this point. But we are maybe looking at, could alcohol be a factor in fill in the blank, whatever you came in for today. Does that make sense, Cece? Yeah. And you know, I was making a little bit of eye contact, but you know, I'm showing her here. I'm wanting her to see this. And then the other thing I would point out to her is, here's what the recommended drinking amounts are. And you are a female that's under 65. So this is your category here. And so what's recommended is that you keep the amount of drinks that you have 7 or under per week. And I think what you reported is putting you somewhere more around 14 to maybe 18 or 20, or maybe even higher, you know, I'm not sure. And so, you know, that's where a lot of people are. And, you know, you're younger, and at this age, it may not be having as much of an impact, but, you know, my job is to help you stay healthy. Or, I might say, your blood pressure was up today, and that could be a factor. Or your blood sugars were up, you know, it looks like you're getting into the pre-diabetes range. Alcohol consumption could be a factor. Okay? So that's how one would introduce this topic. On some of the things I said to you, what are some of your thoughts about the questionnaire you took and the information I just gave you? I'm not going to make you answer. And I would pick on someone. I guess I'll go anyway. So what are some of your thoughts about...
Yes, she goes.
You don't have to say anything. You just have to let me look at you and pretend. You know, what are some of your thoughts about this? I'd really like to hear from you. Has anyone, and if they're just kind of like, I want to hear from me, you know, has anyone ever brought this up with you before? You can. What I did was start with an open-ended question, but if I didn't get much, I went to a close-ended so I could get at least that. And then I'm going to go back to open-ended. And I'm going to keep trying to engage them. Because again, believe me, as scary as it might sound, it's going to go a lot better and it's going to be a lot more efficient if you have open-ended questions. Now, how many are afraid of open-ended questions? How many have ever had somebody, you ask an open-ended question, pretty soon you're hearing about their whole family and that they came over 5 generations ago on the Mayflower or whatever. You know, it just goes into crazy places right off the bat as soon as you ask an open-ended question. So we're going to talk about how to manage that. Occasionally you get someone who does. Generally on this topic, you're not going to have as much of that problem because people aren't quite as sure what to do, you know, and what to say. So I don't want you to be afraid of open-ended questions. Because honestly, in the end, when you ask an open-ended question, you are going to get much more valid information about that person quickly. You could ask 100 questions and not get the most important thing to them. But you can ask one open-ended question and immediately they may tell you why this is meaningful, if you're listening, okay? So it can be more efficient. It's counterintuitive, I know. It can be more efficient in that time when it's not very efficient because you've got someone who just can't wait to tell you everything because they're so lonely or whatever. We'll give you some tools to manage that. here's some reflective questions. Have you had any thoughts today, you know, before today about your alcohol or about the amount of alcohol and what's healthy and whether the amount you're drinking could be playing a role? Have you had thoughts that alcohol might be helping or hurting your mood? You know, people are going to say things like, well, alcohol makes me sleep better. Let me tell you what, it doesn't. It may help you fall asleep. It makes you wake up later. And so you want to hear what are their own thoughts, positive and negative, about alcohol. Because that's how you can be most efficient with your time and have a conversation that's most meaningful to them. Anyway, these are just possible questions. And those are some of those hip pocket questions that you will, you know, have as you learn this process. Have you thought about any important reasons for cutting down? And you might not ask that one right out of the box, but as you've had a conversation, so as you've talked about some of the side effects of alcohol or some of the ways it may be interacting with their biology to create some health concerns. You know, so what now that we've had this conversation, has there been anything said that might be a reason for you to cut back that you heard? And have them start coming up with their own reasons. You don't want to be the one saying, you should be cutting back because I need your blood pressure down by 20 points now, you know, or in 3 months. That won't get you as far as this method. Are we supposed to take a break?
Just whenever you want to weave it in, but events we usually operate in 1 hour chunks or blocks.
Oh, well, we've learned that. Okay. Let's stop here. This is as good as any. And take a 10-minute break. Is that what you normally take?